I want to reiterate some of the points that you made earlier and then ask you to comment if you want to deepen on any of these things, because you made some really fantastic points I want the listeners to listen to and listen to again. And the first one is that employers should be able to hire whomever they want at whatever wage that can be agreed to. And it's not the government's business who I hire or how much I pay, and that in spite of the restrictions the government imposes on immigrants to work, that they still work, they pay taxes, actually maybe even pay more taxes. They expand the economic pie, as you call it, for all of us. And so would you care to comment on those points a little bit further?
Well, it's basic economics. And let me put it in historical perspective. In 1776, when the United States declared its independence formally from Great Britain, the population was about 3 million people. Now, at the time, colonial North America was one of the richest places on Earth, still not as rich as London, right? But it was reasonably rich. We are vastly more wealthy today than colonial America. If the basic underlying economic theory, quote unquote, about immigration is correct, then Thomas Jefferson and James Madison and George Washington, they should have been much wealthier than we are. We are much wealthier. We're much wealthier because now we have millions of people in our economy who are working and creating and contributing to it. Also, think about just today across the country. Manhattan is very, very wealthy and also very, very highly populated. Mississippi's not as wealthy. Right? Now, there's nothing wrong with Mississippi. Some people like to live in more rural, bucolic areas. Other people like to live in very large cities. But the idea that more people in some jurisdiction reduces wages and reduces the standard of living just does not conform to historical fact. Again, just look. What's a richer city, Jackson, Mississippi, or New York? New York. New York
Right,
is a
exactly.
wealthier city.
Let's talk for a second about how restricting immigrants from working creates dangerous black markets. And, government makes the legal market actually more cumbersome by imposing these costs that go on that affect employers to the tune of literally thousands of dollars per employee. Would you please comment on that?
Just in my own neighborhood here in Virginia, we had a case a couple of years ago that was a very sad case. It was a direct result of these restrictions. Day laborers, of course, these people who hang out in parking lots of convenience stores waiting for people to hire them, they know that happens because of restrictions on immigration. And so a couple of years ago, one of these day laborers, a guy from Mexico, he got into a dispute with some guy who hired him to help remodel his home. And the unfortunately, the homeowner, the Mexican, killed him. He murdered him. And obviously, this person should be obviously should be punished. But the with a more open market for labor, these construction workers would be less likely to be hired just off the street. They would be hired by home remodeling firms, for example, and those firms have incentives to screen for, good workers and screen out crazy or potentially violent workers. And so that's one instance where, by forcing people into the shadows, as I think you called it, it harms not only the workers who are forced into the shadows, but it makes the ability of law-abiding Americans to, it makes it more risky for law-abiding Americans to hire these people because there's no effective way to screen out the reliable workers from the less reliable workers. They all get lumped into one pool. So and
That's
that's
right. Well,
one of many bad consequences.
it's also very interesting that these additional costs that are imposed by the government, most folks don't know that the Department of Labor increased the minimum wage for foreign farm workers to $12.24. And, that means that Employers are incentivized not to hire them, but there's other perverse effects, such as the highly skilled foreign people that have specialty occupations. The immigration service typically targets them, which it's kind of a contrary kind of situation where the talk is all about these unskilled laborers, but the immigration effects is being focused really significantly on the skilled laborers.
I'll give you a good example. For 8 years, until last year, I was chairman of the Economics Department at George Mason. And every beginning of every semester, every September and every January, I would have visitors come to my office, and they were always Indians, young Indian men, sometimes Indian women. And they were here on student visas to study engineering at George Mason. And their visas allowed them to work only on campus. They could work on campus, but they could not work off campus. And, of course, there are only a limited number of jobs on campus. And so these engineering students would come to the economics department and basically beg for employment. Say, I can do anything for you. Say, well, you know, I don't have a job for you. I never had the budget to hire them. And so here you have talented, entrepreneurial, smart, energetic people begging for jobs that they can't get, prohibited from going off campus and working for a non-collegiate private employer. Now, not only does that hurt those students, it hurts Americans in general, because the output that we would have gotten from their extra employment, the profits that the American employers would have received from being able to hire them, all that is never created. And that's another, most people don't know about that pernicious effect of immigration restrictions on even those immigrants who are here with the permission of Uncle Sam.
Right. Well, you know, people don't recognize the tremendous benefit that immigrants, not just your grandparents, my grandparents, had made to our economy, but in current day. I mean, the founder of Google is an immigrant.
That's right. The founder of Intel is an immigrant. I mean, in some sense, obviously, we're all immigrants. Mm-hmm. Just some of us, you know, we came here a few generations earlier. It's trite to say, and because it's so trite, people say it so often, it's kind of losing it's losing its meaning, unfortunately. It's certainly losing its emotional impact. But we are a nation of immigrants. And, and you know, the period of greatest immigration as a proportion of the population of the economy was in the late 19th century. You know, from about the 1880s through the first decade of the 20th century. That was a period of enormous economic growth. There was a downturn in the 1890s. It had nothing to do with immigration. It had to do with bad monetary policy. But that was a period of great economic growth. Transcontinental expansion, creation of goods that today we take for granted, telephone, refrigerated railroad cars that enable beef to be slaughtered centrally and shipped across the country and hence lowered the price of food. The guy who invented that is Gustavus Swift, who I believe himself was an immigrant from Germany. The contributions made to the American economy by literal immigrants, by people who were born abroad and came here, is enormous. And when we prevent immigration, we never see the opportunities that Americans are denied because they are not created, because those people who would have created those opportunities for Americans are denied admission, and that's a real shame.
That's an excellent point. So true immigration would make legal channels more appealing and not less. And in that context, let's talk about Arizona. Mm-hmm. So I'm sure that most folks know that Arizona has passed a very strong anti-immigration law, and without belaboring it, I would like to go over a couple of the points about it with you that make this particular law a particular problem model, if you will. Let's start with that there people are guilty until proven innocent.
You know, obviously this is not the American way. As people say, it gives police enormous leeway. Police in Arizona enormous leeway to detain people just on suspicion that they might not be here with the government's permission. Now, the defenders of that Arizona statute will say, oh, no, the people who might be detained in that way have to first be apprehended for committing some other kind of crime. And that's true. But as Judge Napolitano, you mentioned him earlier, points out, and he's a judge, he's seen how law enforcement officers actually work. And he's very concerned that he seems to be certain that the way this statute is written, that it would be very easy for law enforcement authorities who...
Okay, we're going to have to break right now, Don. We'll be right back, folks, for our last segment. Stay with us.